I just wanted to raise some points and offer my encouragement to any attempt to produce agricultural products competitively. But I really want to caution people, because sometimes I think the word sustainability does not necessarily mean competitively. And I think that is the biggest fear that we will always have when people have discussions about sustainability and growing crops. We started producing soybeans in the United States about 70 or 80 years ago. And if I'm not wrong, that at that same time, there was an introduction of soybeans in Europe. And so my question is, after 75 years, why hasn't it happened? And so there's a very good reason why it hasn't happened. And primarily, it just brings down the climate. But alas, that should not be a limitation. Climate is not a limitation. And as I said, I welcome looking at some of the research. I welcome looking at some of the crop potential. The area that you discuss, I think, is a very good potential area. I think Romania, before they ended producing GMO soybeans, was a very, very large and growing producer of soybeans, but somehow they've slowed down. And I think part of the slowing is that you also have to look at this framework and structure. Some of it has to do with the cap itself. Some of it has to do with incentives that are out there that are given to the market that are not necessarily read in those areas. Some of it is price transfer. Some of it is corruption. But by and large, I do feel that, physically speaking, there is a tremendous amount of potential in those particular areas to produce soybeans, because they did it before. Where you can grow corn, you can grow soybeans. As a matter of fact, 50% of that's the 50-50 rotation in the U.S. And where we have not innovated, strangely enough, we've also lost more crop diversity. And if wheat and oats and corn and soybeans were rotated in the United States, and now we're down to a soybean and corn rotation, and there's a very good reason for that. Wheat's not keeping up. Our wheat industry decided a long time ago that, hey, you know, they were spooked. Our friends in Europe don't want our biotech crops, and we won't grow biotech wheat. Lo and behold, we're growing soybeans in North Dakota because of innovation. And those soybeans in North Dakota have come on stream at the same time that we have also seen large amounts of population growth, large amounts of wealth growth in China and in Southeast Asia. And if you really want to know the truth, we do about $1 billion worth of soybean business in Europe for one simple reason. There are better markets. And the reason why the Brazilians and the Argentines sell soybean meal here is because they crush the meal for oil, not for the protein. They're protein saturated, and they sell protein to Europe. And it would be hard-pressed, because as I remember when I was a trader, we used to trade a lot of beans into Rotterdam for the factories in Rotterdam. And there was a tremendous amount of oil that was being, and meal produced in Europe at the time, but that the structure of European business law has put a lot of those places out of business. They are not necessarily competitive, and I think that's what you have to look at. And when you start developing an industry, you also have to develop the industry, the stream. In other words, if beans are going to be 80%, where's your market? $80 a ton more than GMO beans, then you've got to have a market for it. Our price points have shown that everywhere we've begun to have a market that needed product identity. The margins between the GMO and the non-GMO narrowed to the point where it really wasn't profitable to do the GMO. And because you end up, the world is just round, it's open, it's essentially permeable. And therefore, prices in the United States will have an impact on prices in Europe. And I think the reason why an industry, soybeans haven't been grown effectively in Europe is, frankly speaking, when you're self-sufficient in food, you look toward economies. And in looking toward economies, beans just don't fit into the rotation of the farmers, except in a very few areas. And I think that's probably the way it's going to end out. But you'll also find that it still won't meet the demand for 500 million people. And so we think, and I think in any economic theory that you'll find, there always has to be some local supply. It's part of, I think, good planning. But in all the countries in all the history that I know who've sought a certain amount of self-sufficiency, it never worked. What we in economics call self-sufficiency is really a shortened word for economic self-sufficiency. You do what you do best, and you become good enough at that in order to be able to procure the things you need to supplement what you have. And if you can do that, and we work together to make sure that the world market is open for your products and my products, then I think those, the worries that you have about self-sufficiency in soybeans, I think will be allayed. But then you have to do your part, because most of what I've seen is that sustainability isn't necessarily competitive. And when you start looking at what people are doing in the name of sustainability, in the name of the, they're driving themselves to have to put in measures in place that create production, that eliminate efficient trade channels. So I caution everybody, and my real warning is that once you find that all of these things that you begin to implement are not scientifically ready or have challenges in terms of being competitive, that it is not going to do any good to the world trading system if you then start asking for protection. And that's what we're seeing in a lot of countries that are implementing all these things far faster than the technology is available, far faster than they've done the research to get there. And it's a dream. I mean, it's like somebody's reading their favorite book, which is Alice in Wonderland. And they're saying, essentially, I want this wonderful world. And we all want this wonderful world, but I was at, like I said, I was at several conferences before, and the one thing that I was struck by all of it was that the young scientists that are doing this wonderful research to make our better world, to get our carbon footprint right, they just started. And yet we have this wealth of information out there about all of these things that probably are not going to pan out in the long run, because some of them say we can't even feed ourselves. So what we've done in the United States is sort of taken a gradualist approach. And I caution you to take a real gradualist approach to a lot of these things, because and we also, because our land is owned by our farmers. Our land is owned by farmers, and our Constitution means that you can't come on somebody's land and tell them what to do. All right. It may be done here. It may be an edict here. But most of our soil conservation programs are voluntary, and we have over 99% compliance. And you know why we have 99% compliance? We have 99% compliance because our farmers actually benefit from what we do. We implement, we bring in economists in the room, we bring a trader in the room, we sit them in the room with the farmer, and we say, and we bring the environmentalists in the room, we bring the climatologists in the room, and we say, look, you guys work it out, okay? Because the farmer says, I gotta make a living at this. And the trader says, we gotta sell this. And the environmentalist says, we gotta keep this ground clean. Well, we had our Waterloo almost 80 years ago. And when I say Waterloo, we literally had a Waterloo. On the day that Congress was voting for the bill for soil conservation, we had a major dust storm. We have reduced the rate of soil reduction, erosion in the United States by 45% by voluntary means. We've increased our wetlands by over 50%. In the last 30 years, by voluntary means. We showed our farmers where they benefit from it, where they actually will increase their productivity on their farms by doing it. But we don't have 300-meter buffers, because that's taking good farmland out. Biodiversity, we blew that a long time ago. What we did, what we, what we, What we do is, what we try to do is made biorationality. We have forest. We have one of the most extensive forest systems in the world. We have the most extensive soil conservation system in the world. But what we do is we talk to our farmers, because it's his land. And what we say to him, because remember, our farmers are not controlled by the 45% of the EU budget. They are really not. And I heard somebody in the commission say to me once that we don't have to listen to our farmers because we own them. We give them 45% of our budget. We want our farming to look like we want it. Can you imagine a bureaucrat telling you, I want your farm to look like this? And the little old lady who comes to, from America, who comes to Bavaria and says, I want my cows with bells so I can take pictures. And there's these pillars there that allow for that. But these are things that I call dregs. I remember when I was in China and we had a computer system and it was run through all of these things and all of these network scrubbers so that the Chinese couldn't hack into what we were doing. Where every one of those things that we had slowed down the flow of information. They slowed down our efficiency. And I think with all of these city people determining what farmers are doing here, it's slowing down innovation. It's slowing down productivity. And that if you really wanted soybeans in Europe, if you really want soybeans in Europe, I would suggest wholeheartedly that you take a long and honest look at the need for innovation, at the need for voluntarism, at the need for cost-benefit analysis in planning for all of these things. Because I do believe it's possible. I do believe it's necessary. I do not consider Europe a competitor. There are no competitors in the world anymore. There are 7 billion people this month, right? Mm-hmm. 7 billion people this month. They say it's almost going to be 10 billion now in 2050. We're going to need every hectare.
Yeah.
We're going to need everything we got in order for us to feed the rest of the world. And so I submit to you, be rational in your approach, be thoughtful in your approach, and above all, talk to your farmers.